Our next speaker is Gilbert Smith from University of California, Irvine. And he will be talking to us about genome-wide DNA methylation patterns in wild samples of two morphotypes of threespine stickleback.
So I'd just like to start by thanking the organizers for inviting me. I think it's been a really interesting set of talks so far. Also to SSE for funding. So I'm going to talk about some work we did at the University of St. Andrews. This is looking at genome-wide DNA methylation in patterns of threespine stickleback that included two different morphotypes. Okay, so just some sort of brief background. I think this is some background we've seen a number of times before today, but we'll go through some of my definitions, I guess. So epigenetics means above the level of genes. This is a very broad definition, really. What we do is we tend to think about epigenetics as a change in gene expression without a change in DNA sequence. More specifically, when we think about epigenetic marks, these are the chemical modifications to DNA, RNA, and proteins, and these different changes can be include DNA methylation, which I'm going to talk about today, histone modifications, and RNA-based regulatory systems. The cool thing about epigenetics and these different marks is they do tend to work in conjunction or interact when controlling, say, gene expression or chromatin state modifications. I just wanted to very quickly illustrate this. So here we have a gene in blue along a stretch of DNA. This is this example from Stella 2011. It's a tumor suppressor gene. And just upstream, we have a CPG island, so a dense region of CPGs, and a complex histone. So this is a histone wrapping up the DNA, and you can see there are different methylation marks in the histones here too. What you can get in this example is DNA methylation at this CPG island, recruiting a methylated DNA binding protein, and ending up wrapping up the DNA in the histone. So this tends to lead to a repression of gene expression. And also just to add in small RNAs, these can also be repressed as well, kind of back to normal function. So there's a whole bunch of stuff going on with epigenetics. What sort of biological roles do epigenetics play? Well, they're involved in normal development, in tissue differentiation, in tumor growth, and a number of other diseases actually. Transposable element control, and also genomic imprinting. And this is just a few, and we've seen a few other talks that have shown us some really interesting stuff that's going on. And I'm sure that there's a lot more we don't even know about, actually. But one thing that's kind of gathering growing evidence is a role for epigenetic marks in genetic plasticity. And I should say, it's not synonymous, epigenetic marks or epigenetics and plasticity are not synonymous, as Josh pointed out, and I think that's a really, really important point. But I guess mechanistically is how I'm able to be interested in epigenetic marks and their role in plasticity. So this is interesting. So plasticity is a phenotypic change, a bound genotypic change in response to an environmental signal. And epigenetic marks themselves can be environmentally modified. I think it's been very well shown in a few talks we've seen. And so I just wanted to very quickly bring that back to the whole evolutionary process, which is the topic of this symposium. So plasticity can play a role in evolution by buffering against environmental change, also relying on subsequent selection to act. This is what we call genetic evolution. So really, all of this is the sort of context that I became interested in epigenetics. And now I'm normally an insect person, I look at insect gene expression, but I got talking and I got very interested in the threespine stickleback. So this is where I decided to write a little graph, and I've got some money to have a look at this. So the threespine stickleback are really cool for evolutionary studies. They have a whole bunch of different phenotypes across all these different global populations in the form of ecotypes. So I'm not going to go into too much detail, there's a lot of cool stuff going on. But basically, the marine ancestor stickleback around the end of the last ice age, during glacial retreats, invaded some freshwater environments, the lakes, and continental uplift trapped these guys in these lakes, and a whole bunch of different ecotypes evolved to adapted to the freshwater conditions. But one really cool thing, and another really cool thing about this, is that it's repeated. It's what we have is kind of these natural evolutionary replicates across the world of an adaptive event. So I'm focusing on sort of what we call these two different morphotypes here. They're kind of morphological types representative of different ecotypes. So what we have is the complete plate morph, so these are lateral plate morphs. The complete plate morph tends to be high frequency in a marine environment and have lots of these lateral plates, so they're not normally red. Obviously, I've just highlighted them red to show you where these lateral plates are. And the sort of other extreme of this phenotype is the low plate morph, which is found in high frequency and freshwater environments. And the difference is because, probably, or most likely because of differences in predation, so they act as a part of these plates. But there are a whole bunch of differences in different ecotypes, not just in their plate, but also you can see in their body size. The marine ones tend to be slightly larger, but also in trophic specializations, pigmentation, elsewhere regulation, life history, and mating preferences. So there's a whole bunch of different phenotypes that are different communities and fish. One last thing that I wanted to point out about this adaptation to fresh water is it can be extremely rapid, surprisingly rapid. So in this lake in Alaska, it's a freshwater lake when all the ecotypes were exterminated in 1983. The marine types invaded, and here where we can see it, but it starts in 1990. They did it, this paper here did a survey of the complete and the low morph frequencies. And so the complete morph in 1990 was like more than 90%. And in only 12 years, it went down to 11%, and the low morph increased. Dominated. So this can be extremely rapid, and I just want to sort of reiterate phenotypic plasticity that's probably involved in this is predicted to play a role in adaptation. So like I said, we're interested in epigenetics and sticklebacks, but there is no epigenetic information in sticklebacks other than just for a few genes, so we wanted to look genome-wide. So the aim was pretty simple for this study, was to simply look at genome-wide epigenetic patterns and DNA methylation patterns in wild samples, including two different morphotypes. So we took our samples from a pool called the Locust Pool in St Andrews up in Scotland. So for those who don't know, Scotland is still is part of the United Kingdom. And St Andrews is on the east coast of Scotland. So Locust Pool is a small man-made pool. It's a freshwater pool. And it has a resident population of the freshwater fish or the low morphotype. But because it's right near the coast and near tidal streams, there's a regular influx of the marine ecotype or the complete morph. And the last survey we did showed that there's about 20% of the population is this marine complete morph. So we took four females and took four females of the complete morph and the low morph. Didn't do males, that was just budget constraints, unfortunately. We'd like to do that in the future. And we took a really quite large sample of that tissues. So we took a whole bunch of different tissue types, things from the pectoral fin all the way to the base of the caudal fin. And the reason we did that, firstly, we didn't know what tissue type we needed to target, actually, to go through. And the reason we took it in a standardized way was we didn't want to mess up the different proportions or get sort of different combinations of tissue types. And to kind of illustrate this, is because we didn't really take a whole bunch of different tissues. So we took this entire flank, we only took one flank, but we took the entire flank, and this is a section through that flank of the tissue that we collected. And you can see the loads of different tissue types. So it starts with the scale, you've got the epidermis, the dermis, subcutaneous tissue, and the muscle tissue as well. So this doesn't include smaller micro variations, so blood, the glands, anything else that these different tissue types also might have to the variation. So it was a broad survey of lots of different tissue types. So what we did was to take the sample skin and the muscle section. Extracted the DNA and performed this thing called reduced representation by subsequence, RBS. So we've seen this new cool method that everyone's talking about. It's not too different from everything. The sound of it is just a lot more expensive. But RBS is really quite useful. And it involves a restriction digest and a bisulfite conversion and size selection. So what we're doing here is targeting CpG motifs. This is the sort of most functional or at least highly methylated motifs in vertebrates. So we're not doing the plants with all the different C and HSC. So you see types of motifs, both in the CpG motifs. So when we do the restriction digest and the size selection, what we're doing is chopping up the genome and enriching the regions of CpGs, which we hope to be the CpG islands. So very briefly, the bisulfite conversion itself is a chemical deamination of cytosines into thiamines. So you can see for the untreated DNA you've got all these Cs, and for the bisulfite treated DNA you've got a single C next to a G, and this is protected by a methyl group, and so it's methylated. So when you do this in conjunction with the sequencing, you get millions and millions of reads, just this kind of information, and you can build up a profile across all those tissue types, and you get a proportion of methylation across all those tissue types in each CpG that you've sequenced the genome. So, onto a little bit of results from analysis. Sequencing produced 100 base pairs per in reads, and on average, library sizes were 59 million reads. And we map the reads to the genome, so we do have a genome, which is great advantage, and it's not a bad genome, it's a pretty good genome. And we map using BISMARC, which is just for mapping methylation data. And on average, we found 58% of all the sequence cytosines in our data were methylated. So I'd say that's pretty high percentage. And as a sort of side note, there's various non-CPG methylation, which isn't too surprising as we get into CPG regions. We've also got those non-CPG methylation as well. And so we quantified methylation at each of our CpG sites, and we did this thing where we smooth methylation levels. We'll say that I use this R pattern by seq, I recommend it, it's really cool, it's really useful, and all the analysis you're going to see will come from by seq. But I wanted to point out this sort of smooth methylation that we did. So it's a good way of dealing with low coverage parts of the genome that you got, some bits where you didn't get as much, as many reads of that part of the genome. So these sort of light circles here are lower coverage and presumably slightly less robust estimates of DNA methylation. So this is positioned along a stretch of DNA and then methylation proportion here. And so this purple line kind of averages out, although it's a bit more complicated than that, essentially averages out the methylation proportion along the genome. We give you a more robust estimate of HCPG of the methylation level. So last thing I want to point out, when we talk about methylation, we are talking about proportions here. So I always say a percentage of methylation. So in total, we surveyed 1.45 million CpGs across all eight samples. That was the amount of information we had for every sample. We'll make sure we had data for every sample. So that's quite a good survey, I think, quite a good sampling across the genome. So the first thing that we did was to look at highly methylated regions of the genome. So why do we look at regions? Well, it's thought that functional methylation is more likely to occur, play a role in clusters of methylated CpGs. So like I said before, these CpG islands, you get methylated CpG islands, it leads to a repressed gene, generally speaking at least. So we didn't want to just focus on single or individual CpGs, we wanted to focus on regions that are more likely to be functional. So we define highly methylated regions as CpG regions containing at least 10 CpGs separated by no more than 100 base pairs with at least 90% methylation in all eight samples. So this really is quite highly methylated. So this is just kind of a summary. It's not really the best graph to show it, but it is pretty. So basically, we have each chromosome here, 1 to 21, anything you really can't see it, and I apologize for that. But this last one here is mitochondrial, second to last is mitochondrial. And then we have all of these scaffolds that are on either side. The black line shows this 90% cutoff, and this is for the whole 1.5 million or something. That's quite a lot of data on there to walk around. So in total, we found 16,950 CBGs with more than 90% methylation. And this was within 912 highly methylated regions. And I would also point out, and I did mean to forget, just like put this on here, that there was very, very low methylation in the mitochondrial regions. And this is quite common across most species, I think. And it's something to do with the fact that there's fewer CBG motifs associated with So, to give some genomic context, meaning onto that, some biological context in these highly methylated regions, we worked out the nearest gene to each highly methylated region as measured by the transcription and the distance to this transcription start site, so this is the TSS here. So, on average, we found that the nearest gene to each HMR was 7,172 base pairs. And to look at where they were in the genome, so where they are in genomic features, so exons, introns, and intergenic promoter regions. This donut chart here, the outer ring is the proportion of HMR positions in the genome, HMR features, and the inner ring is the genome-wide content. And so asterisk shows significant differences. So interestingly, it's pretty obvious that there's a whole bunch of highly methylated regions in exons, by far. And this is interesting. I think this has been shown in quite a few other species, and as Bob's talk showed, this could just be apparently junk methylation. So there's also underrepresentation in the introns and intergenic regions, but regardless of its function, it seems that a lot of highly methylated regions are in genes and within exons too. So then for the biological context, we performed functional enrichment tests for the ongoing terms of the functions of each of the genes that is associated with the highly methylated regions. So you do a functional enrichment test for these ongoing terms, and these ones are biological process going terms, and I'll move on to the method function in a second, but we'll focus more on the biological. So this figure here is a tree map. Basically, for each going term that you get, you put it in a little box, and it's the box, the size of the box is proportional to the size of the p-value, the corrected p-value. And each go term is also clustered into a supercluster of functionally related terms. So that way we can really summarize what's going on and not have too many redundant terms there. And so these names involved, go terms involved, are the summary for those clusters. So you can see there's a couple of interesting things going on here. We have the go-terms for gene expression. This is perhaps not too surprising that DNA methylation has a role in regulating gene expression, DNA binding proteins. We have also this nucleoside biphosphate metabolism, which is actually involved in the purine salvage pathway. So this is where your cells recycle nucleotides and regulate their levels to feed into gene expression. So that's kind of cool. We also have this toll signaling pathway, and in some of the toll signaling pathway is involved in development and immunity. So this is in body patterning and detection of microbial infections. But invertebrates and toll signaling pathways tend to be involved really just in immune response. So I think in this context or in this case, probably involved in immune response. And I just wanted to point out just two of these other go-terms, biological process go-terms, angiogenesis, which is blood vessel growth, and biological adhesion, and I just wanted to point them out because they're going to come back. I'm going to come back to them with that in the second analysis. Very briefly, a look at the molecular function go-terms. So we see gene regulator, enzyme regulator activity, binding, protein binding, methyl ion binding, surprisingly sort of regulatory. It's kind of cool. These ones out. So this is histone epigenetic one related go-term. So this is, we've got methyl transferase, acyl transferase here, histones. This is kind of fun. This is DNA methylation regulating genes that create other epigenetic ones. So the second analysis we did was to look at differentiating mating regions in the genome. So this is looking at differences between the complete apical and the lobe. What we wanted to do first before we went on with the analysis was to actually look at the relationship of all the samples. And we did find that two of the samples, so we've got, luckily it was symmetrical, so we've got one complete hump and one lobe orb, were actually outliers to the rest of these biological replicants. So what we did was to exclude those two outliers from the analysis and to go on and use three replicates of the beak and three replicates of the lobe for the differential analysis. So we define differentially methylated regions as CpG regions containing at least 10 CpGs separated by no more than a base pair so similar to the highly methylated regions. This time they have an average 50% difference between the orbs. And BISEC does this kind of two-tier significance testing. So it does a wall test for group effects, which what that does is to choose the differentially methylated regions. And then it trims these differentially methylated regions down to the most significant CpGs. So it tests the CpGs individually and pulls out the strongest signal. And both of these are controlled by force discovery rate. So again, by eye, just a quick look at the differential methylation. So increased methylation is towards an increase in B orb, and negative methylation is an increase in the low orb. And see by eye, you may not be able to see, I can see that there are sort of a few obvious regions here. So it's mean methylation difference across the samples that we're looking at now by chromosome again. And so in chromosome 1, there's kind of increased methylation in the low orb. There's a big group in chromosome 5, and a group there again on chromosome 18. So we can see that there are definitely some differences going on just by eye, and again, the no differential methylation, so there's no differential here. So what did we find? Well, in total, we found 77 significant BMRs. It was 41 increased in the complete and 36 increased in the lobe. So there wasn't too much sort of symmetry differences there. So this heat map shows the differences in each of these 77 BMRs. The green is low methylation, and the red is high methylation, and black methylation is just symptoms of more between levels. So I don't know if you can see, but there aren't too many really extreme differences from very low to very high, or vice versa. And it tends to be sort of moderate levels to low, or moderate levels to high changes. Again, we wanted to look at the genomic and eventually biological context, so we calculated how far away the nearest genes or nearest transcription start sites were to each of these BMRs. And on average, a bit further away than HMRs by about 2,000 base pairs, so on average, genes were 9,750 base pairs away from BMRs. And again, here, features, BMR genomic features, the outer ring is now the DMRs, the inner ring is still the same, gene and Y content. And this time we see the majority of DMRs are located in intergenic regions. And actually, there's an underrepresentation of chromatin regions. This is kind of interesting because a lot of DNA methylation is thought to occur in chromatin regions, a lot of functional DNA methylation. So it's interesting that it's actually slightly further away in intergenic regions. I can wave my hands a bit at what this might be about. It could be that it's in enhancer regions, given that the average distance is further away from the average. Genes and the HMRs. It's an interesting observation. So again, we took these nearest genes, took their go-turn functions, did a functional enrichment test. This is another tree map of those functions. This time we have cardiovascular system development and notch signaling genes, which are quite interesting. I am going to speed up now. And actually, I'm going to pull out just a few genes that I thought were quite interesting, just to see if your favorite gene might be up. So for the developmental process and cardiovascular system development, like GoTurns, we also include these developmental growth and growth-related functions. And we see a four-head box, C1B gene, which is involved in endothelial gene regulation. Interesting, because we did sample of the endothelial layers. We see a growth factor, receptor, so these insulin-like growth factors are involved in development and growth. And we see two angiogenesis genes, probably one of Rowell's, and this, again, this is blood vessel development. And to refer it back to a highly methylated region, we see kind of functional overlap. And we have another signaling pathway, this time it's the Notch signaling pathway. We have a gene involved in vascular remodeling as well as Notch signaling, so I think this is some functional overlap between those co-terms. Two involved in signaling pathway, generally it's these YNA nucleic shared exchange factors. And a Notch binding protein, jagged one. I'm just going to highlight just a couple of more interesting genes as well. We've got this BMC2 gene, which is involved in the craniofacial bones in mice and adult pigmentation in zebrafish. And I've already pointed out the IGF-1 receptor gene here. We've also found TRPM5, so a TRIM channel. And the chip channels and then IGF receptors are involved in epithelial growth in zebrafish in a calcium dependent. And lastly, we have the protocut hearing gene, which are the neural cell adhesion molecules, and they're important during development because they are important in somite development. These are the layers that give rise to the dermal layers, lots of skin related dermal layers, go-term. But also, it's this cell adhesion go-term, again, which came on the HMR, so it's this functional. So these are probably the most interesting go-terms, things related to development, cardiovascular development, growth, and Notch signaling. We know there are differences in aerobic capacity between the marine epiphytes and the freshwater stickleback. So that's in ventricle size, oxygen consumption, and muscle mass. And we know there are also plastic differences in growth rates and body size and body shape, that having a more so these link in nicely to our go-terms. Of course, this is just association. I had a look at the molecular process go-terms too, and these are just called number of regulatory activities, energy production, and enzyme regulation. So in summary, we see substantial DNA methylation in this stickleback genome. The highly methylated region is associated with gene expression regulation and cellular signaling, and differentially methylated regions associated with genes of function and cellular signaling different type developed and broken in the cardiovascular system. And there was this interesting observation that's functional overlaps between highly methylated and differentially methylated regions in terms of blood vessel growth and cell adhesion. Very quickly, I just want to say what I want to do next, and really will be very quick. The idea is to identify plasticity loci in the stickleback genome, so regions of the genome that are controlling individual plasticity. And we hope to do this by dissecting the different plastic responses across lots of different several different populations. We have these evolutionary replicas of our freshwater adaptation. We hope to do this by looking at gene expression in conjunction with epigenetic data of different kinds in control labs. With that, I have definitely run out of time. I'd like to thank two co-founders, Mike Ritchie and Carl Smith, a whole bunch of people that helped with the sequencing and analysis, and it's all funded by them. Thank you very much for taking the questions.
We have time for one question.
So do these morphs you see, do they have specific plasticity? So the pond you had, there were marine and fresh animals?
Yeah.
And the marine animals you took from that pond as well?
So this is the thing, this was just a sampling from one population. So
yeah.
Didn't test plasticity here.
Okay.
That's the context we're interested in, but really we just wanted to take a whole bunch of samples from the wild and look at the DNA population patterns.
These are fixed morph differences then, right?
Fixed in what sense?
In that, so if you had a marine individual reared in fresh water, it's still going to look like a marine individual as far as the...
Well, there could definitely be plasticity there.
Yeah.
But what we did, it was like one, it's a time stamp, it was like just one place, at one time, we sampled from one population to two different ones.
Yeah.
So we didn't look directly at plasticity. This is definitely something we want to do in the future.
I mean, you need to do this beforehand.
Yeah.
Okay.